Welcome to this public worship service here at St John's Presbyterian Church, Anerley, with our resident pastor, Reverend Martin Duffield, leading our worship. Just a reminder of a few points as we meet under these new conditions. Hand sanitizer is available at both main entries for use when entering and exiting the church. And also, there will not be a meet and greet by the preacher at the conclusion of the services. Therefore, following the benediction, please be seated. Again, we commend to you our church family under some difficulty. We are now encouraged to engage in personal preparation just prior to the call to worship. Thank you.
Worship our God in this evening hour again this week, this Lord's Day. Our call to worship comes from the 104th Psalm, and verses 33 and 34 toward the end of the Psalm in these words. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. May my meditation be sweet to him. I will be glad in the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord. So may it be for us as we sing his praise and hear him speak to us tonight. Let's respond to his word by bringing our words of prayer to him this evening. Let's all pray. Our Almighty God, as we have gathered again in your presence on this Lord's Day, we do so thankful for your many mercies, especially as we have seen and heard in the recent times living examples of that great rebellion of humanity against God. In so many ways, we are reminded that there, the things that we see, for example, in the resistance to the pandemic control in other parts of our country and around the world, the general lawlessness are all things that are pointers to the wide and long revolt that humanity has been in against your authority and against your lordship. But as we gather to worship tonight, we humble ourselves in your great presence. Because as the President of the United States has recently said, the only one to whom we will bow the knee is Almighty God. We recognise no man's sovereignty, but God's sovereignty alone. We own instead our submission to your will and our allegiance to all your cause and purposes as we have gathered in your presence this evening. Our Father in heaven, though the rule of law may be under assault in many places, here in this place, your law rules in love and truth. We rejoice in having peace and prosperity because you established your lordship in this place and in our hearts. And our worship, our ministry, and our witness is all under your sovereign hand, and gladly so, and all in accordance with your sovereign will, and all energized by the Spirit who is Christ among us, in power and wisdom. Every part of our preparation is governed by compliance with your will, because every part of that preparation is for your glory and our blessing. And you alone know what is best for us to accomplish those things. We will listen to no man, to no men, to no institutions, but we will search your revelation alone for that true and holy way to glorify you in worship and in the practice of Christian ministry. And so, our Lord, accept our sacrifices of praise this evening. And accept them through Jesus Christ our Lord. Help us through the Holy Spirit to give to you what belongs to you in every part of the service as we pray for every part of our lives. May our hearts and our minds be bent toward your will and purpose, that your blessing may flow unhindered to us, and all of that to the praise of your glory. And these things we seek to that end tonight, in our Lord Jesus' precious name. Amen. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation, is our song of praise. first reading this evening comes from the book of the law in Numbers in chapter 16.
That's Numbers chapter 16, verses 1 to 23. Verse 1. Now Korah, the son of Izhar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi, with Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and On, the son of Peleth, sons of Reuben, took men. And they rose up before Moses with some of the children of Israel, 250 leaders of the congregation, representatives of the congregation, men of renown. They gathered together against Moses and Aaron and said to them, "You take too much upon yourselves, for all the congregation is holy, every one of them, and the Lord is among them. Why then do you exalt yourselves above the assembly of the Lord?" So when Moses heard it, he fell on his face, and he spoke to Korah and all his company, saying, "Tomorrow morning the Lord will show who is his and who is holy, and will cause him to come near to him. That one whom he chooses, he will cause to come near him. Do this, take censers, Korah, and all your company, and put fire in them, and put incense in them before the Lord tomorrow. And it shall be that the man whom the Lord chooses is the holy one. You take too much upon yourselves, you sons of Levi." Then Moses said to Korah, "Hear now, you sons of Levi. Is it a small thing to you that the God of Israel has separated you from the congregation of Israel to bring you near to himself, to do the work of the tabernacle of the Lord, and to stand before the congregation to serve them? And that he has brought you near to himself, you and all your brethren, the sons of Levi, with you? And are you seeking the priesthood also? Therefore you and all your company are gathered together against the Lord. And what is Aaron that you complain against him?" And Moses sent to call Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab. But they said, "We will not come up. Is it a small thing that you have brought us up out of a land flowing with milk and honey to kill us in the wilderness, that you should keep acting like a prince over us? Moreover, you have not brought us into a land flowing with milk and honey, nor given us inheritance of the fields and vineyards. Will you put out the eyes of these men? We will not come up." Then Moses was very angry and said to the Lord, "Do not respect their offering. I have not taken one donkey from them, nor have I hurt one of them." And Moses said to Korah, "Tomorrow you and all your company be present before the Lord, you and they, as well as Aaron. Let each take his censer and put incense in it, and each of you bring his censer before the Lord, 250 censers, both you and Aaron, each with his censer." So every man took his censer, put fire in it, laid incense on it, and stood at the door of the tabernacle of meeting with Moses and Aaron. And Korah gathered all the congregation against them at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Then the glory of the Lord appeared to all the congregation. And the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, "Separate yourselves from among this congregation, that I may consume them in a moment." Then they fell on their faces and said, "O God, the God of the spirits of all flesh, shall one man sin, and you be angry with all the congregation?" So the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to the congregation, saying, get away from the tents of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram." And to God be all the glory. Amen.
Amen. Let's respond to that sobering portion of God's word by bringing our confessions to him this evening. Let's all pray. Our Holy Father in heaven, if there is any sin that finds its way into our lives regularly, it is a sin of resistance to your will. The cry of the apostle that he could not do what he wanted, and that he does what he doesn't want to do, is ours. But it is more than that. We resist you and your will in ways that we sometimes cannot even sense, and often only until we've been exposed for our motives, or by the later measure of the truth that's been brought to bear on us, that we see what we have done. We confess that every sin, no matter how small, is resistance to you. You call for perfect, perpetual obedience, and we can only offer at best imperfect, intermittent obedience at your will. It is good that we have grace, for the law of the conscience and the spirit crush us with blow after blow of guilt and failure. Yes, thanks be to God that the sins are less serious as time passes. And thanks be to you that they are less frequent, for that is the mark of a life of growing in grace and holiness. But our Father, we remain in the struggle against that most powerful of foes, which is our own flesh, and which flesh drives us to resist you in so many ways. We struggle and we fail, but thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ that forgiveness awaits the penitent, that satisfaction and increasing satisfaction awaits those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Well, Lord, as we grow in love for you, as we grow in desire for your presence, we also grow in desire for your help. We do not want to return sin for love, resistance for grace and mercy. In our heart, we know we only want to be like you, like Jesus Christ our Lord. We only want to live filled with the Spirit and not quenching or grieving him. So help us to find wisdom and discernment that we may have the power and the knowledge required to walk in your ways, to submit to your demands and calls, and to bring not only glory to you, but pleasure to you, our Father, in our obedience. And this we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to sing from the Psalms tonight. The Lord God hear you, Psalm 12.
Thank you.
Titus chapter 3, verses 1 to 14. Verse 1. Remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to obey, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing all humility to all men. For we ourselves were also once foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving various lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But when the kindness and the love of God our Saviour toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Saviour, that having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a faithful saying, and these things I want you to affirm constantly, that those who have believed in God should be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men. But avoid foolish disputes, genealogies, contentions, and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and useless. Reject a divisive man after the first and second admonition, knowing that such a person is warped and sinning, being self-condemned. When I send Artemis to you, or Tychicus, be diligent to come to me at Nicopolis, for I have decided to spend the winter there. Send Zenas the lawyer and Apollos on their journey with haste, that they may lack nothing. And let our people also learn to maintain good works, to meet urgent needs, that they may not be unfruitful. And again, to God be all the glory. Amen.
We shall thank God in a moment for his mercies to us in the week, but in the meantime we shall just take a moment to meditate upon those good things. For this we thank you this evening with our offerings. This is why the world's Marxist groups try to overthrow the knowledge of God and the church as a fundamental aim of their efforts. They know that it is the strength of our culture as it is our strength, and that it comes from you, and that it is the foundation for our quality of life and its productivity. Tonight we give you thanks for your lordship of our lives and for that wisdom, peace and power by which we are able to do all things in meeting our own needs and sharing with others. We bring our gifts to thank you for all these blessings in our Lord Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen. We're going to sing Faith of Our Fathers now. Well, we come to the preaching of the word. Let's take a moment to pray for others. We're going to pray for a couple of local churches first, Presbyterian Works, and then we're going to go to consider the needs of the international world just briefly, especially the United States. So let's just meet with God again. Lord, we do thank you for the evangelical spirit that is in our denomination. We thank you for the work of the Graceful Charge in establishing the work of Maruka in a neighbouring suburb to us. Jeff Taken, his wife and his young family, and for the small band of believers who have gathered in the hall that they meet in Maruka. And we do pray for them as they meet in that hall that you would help them to find a place where they can finally call home and they can purchase it and establish their ministry there for many generations. We pray also, our God, for the ministry and the message that goes out from Jeff and from those in the congregation, that it would be faithful, true to the word of God, energized by the Spirit and effective in drawing people into the kingdom of God. We pray also for the work that is now called City South, is focusing on West End, and they require a place to stay and they require resources to do that, Lord, and we seek your aid for them. As they serve you, that you would be pleased to give them the things that they need to establish that work and to carry out a faithful ministry in the West End area. We pray also, our God, for the government of the United States, as we look upon that nation with a sense of sad awe that this nation, which was a bastion of the free market, of free speech, of democracy, is now being assaulted in so many places and so violently night after night. And recently we have seen, for the first time in a long time, Bibles being burnt in the city of Portland, which has exposed the real purpose of much of what's going on in that country. Thank you for the speech at Dakota, South Dakota, of the president, which he exposed all of the motives and the people that are behind these things, and they have nothing to do in the end with the cause, the noble cause of ridding the country of racism. We do continue to pray for the current government led by President Trump, that the rule of law might come back to that nation, that you would be pleased to continue to guide it through the very stormy and dangerous waters of 40 million unemployed, and of a near certain depression, to confront that nation and other nations once the money that's been given by those governments and the American government eventually runs out. But Lord, we know not what the future holds, but we look at it with great concern given the circumstances that prevail. So help them, we pray, to be able to manage this very difficult thing. And guide the American people as they come into the election. It's in October this year, less than 100 days away, that they would make the right choice to continue the reforms of the current administration in terms of the pro-life movement, in terms of the court system, so that eventually righteousness might be established in the institutions of the United States. We do continue to pray, our God, for the Queen and the Governor General, David Hurley. We thank you for this godly man, who was the Queen's representative in Australia. And Lord, guide both these people as they go about their daily tasks to uphold the law, to maintain their integrity as Christians, and to play their part in the democracy in which we live. We pray, our God, now that as we come to the Word of God, that you would be pleased to teach us on the sobering subject of dealing with those who cannot be reasoned with. And we pray for wisdom and humility, for grace as we address this portion of Paul's letter to Titus, so that we might be equipped in this area where an area where we would rather not go, but which inevitably, because of the fall of the human race and corruption in human nature, we must. So help us, we pray, to understand the things that you have left for us, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So, as you can see from the title in your service sheets, problem of recalcitrance. We are dealing with an unpleasant subject. Some people say you should start a speech or any kind of oratory with a negative. Well, the text is a negative, so we've got to deal with it as it is. Hopefully we'll get some practical help out of it. It's verses 9 to 11. You don't need to go there, but I'll read it quickly. But avoid foolish disputes, genealogies, contentions, and strivings about the law, because they're unprofitable and useless. Reject the divisive man after a first and second admonition, knowing that such a person is warped and sinning, being self-condemned. From time to time, in discussions with non-religious people, I hear them speak with disturbance and even contempt of conflict within the church. I understand their thinking. They assume that Christians have very high ideals regarding brotherly love, ethical integrity, the unity of purpose, and the grace of forgiveness. So how can an organisation with those kind of ideals and aims in theory be disrupted by behaviour and conflict that are the opposite of those ideals? Well, the answer to that concern lies in a number of unspoken assumptions in non-religious people that are actually delusions. Firstly, there is the assumption that everyone in the church can live and wants to live in accordance with those ideals all the time. Second, it assumes that only people like that ever frequent the church and become its members. And neither of those statements is true. We know that nobody can ever live perfectly up to those ideals any more than people can live up to them outside of the church. Further, not only can true Christians sometimes behave badly, but sometimes there are people who are not truly Christians who come in and who behave badly naturally. Such critics cannot have seen the many warnings from Jesus himself and the apostles about those who seek their own interests and do so to the church's harm and the people. Remember the parables, like the parable of the tares and the wheat. Remember the warnings about ravenous wolves in sheep's clothing. They all speak of real life in the church. Good men sometimes do bad things, and sometimes bad men are just being themselves, even if they don't think or know that they are really bad, but instead think they actually serve God by their actions, as Jesus warned. So as we look at Titus 3:9-11, we are facing this very sad situation of the church confronted with and having to confront people that are damaging the church and hurting its membership. In this case, they are within the congregation at the time, although the New Testament does deal with drifters who come into the church in terms of false teachers and how to approach them and protect the congregation from them. But we have before us tonight a kind of scenario of discipline, but one in which the great goal of discipline, which is repentance and reform, are simply not able to be achieved. And that is why the title of tonight, The Problem of the Recalcitrant. We shall consider the behaviour, the damage, the defects of the recalcitrant, and then we shall look briefly at the antidote. So the behaviour of the recalcitrant. The particular means by which these people inflict injury upon fellowships is listed here in a number of forms. The first is called foolish questions. The word foolish here in the Greek is the word from which we get our English word moron. Debates, questions, and controversies are sometimes necessary and even important. But when they are over utter irrelevancies, then they are the very opposite. They are what we would call petty issues, and yet because of pride or envy, people can tear into each other and invite others to join in the mad conflict. They are foolish because those who pursue them should know better than to argue about them, much less to the point of rupturing an otherwise peaceful and united fellowship. They're foolish because they do not build people up in them. In fact, they're foolish too because they often take people away from Scripture. They inflame emotions and they seed divisions among the brethren. So that's the first one concerning foolish debates. The second one is the question of endless genealogies. And I'll let Albert Barnes, one of the great Presbyterian commentators, described this. He said this also refers to Jewish teaching. The Hebrews kept careful genealogical records, for this was necessary in order that the distinction of their tribes might be kept up. Of course, in the lapse of the centuries, these tables would become very numerous, complicated, and extended, so that they might, without much exaggeration, be called endless. The Jews attached great importance to them and insisted on their being carefully preserved. As the Messiah, however, had now come, and as the Jewish polity was to cease, as the separation between them and pagan was no longer necessary, and the distinctions of the tribes was now useless, there was no propriety that these distinctions should be regarded by Christians. The whole system was, moreover, contrary to what is the genius of Christianity, because it served to keep up the pride of blood and birth, that is, of Jewish descent. And that's the point, isn't it? Records that which had no longer had any proof were being used by people to brag and assert superiority. Remember, Paul expressed his disgust at having to defend his apostleship in 2 Corinthians 12 against his critics by referring to the fact that, like them, he actually had a lineage from the tribe of Benjamin. But it is one thing to study genealogies for historical purposes, and Korean Christians are one culture who love genealogical portions of Scripture because for them, ancestry is very important. But in the case of others, it is simply a means of inflating egos and looking down upon them because of their lineage or lack thereof. Another one was disputes about the law. This was an evil inherited from the tradition of the Pharisees, and it is sometimes called majoring on the minors. It is making a big deal out of something that in the end, again, has little consequence. Again, here is another good summary of this precise problem, this time from the Baptist Charles Ellicott. The strivings about the law were most probably arguments suggested by disputed and intricate points connected with the law of Moses. In the Talmud, which is the Jewish commentary, ancient commentaries on the Old Testament, in the Talmud we possess unnumbered instances of these strange, curious little inquiries about which men gravely disputed and wrangled, but none of which could in any way teach men how to make life more beautiful and loving, more like that fair pattern which St. Paul's master had loved. That being Jesus, of course. There is a great deal of truth in the saying that small things amuse small minds. Too many conflicts like this have caused painful rifts in Christ's body, which have never been worth the pain. As Christians, we have the responsibility to pursue things of importance, of weight, and of real concern to the body of Christ. And the aim of that is either that the congregation either be built up, or in pursuing it, that the congregation is not torn down. It is a wise leader and a wise member who refuses any such argument and therefore avoids the controversy. Remember, there will always be people with quirky ideas. They can be addressed graciously, and they can equally be graciously resisted, but they must never be allowed to become a weapon in the hands of the immature, or worse, a weapon in the hands of the true enemies of the church, who are identified by their determination to assert themselves, in this case, against the authorities of the church, with no regard for the collateral damage. And that brings us to the second point this evening, beyond the behaviour. We look at what happens as a result of this. We're looking at the damage of the recalcitrant. So what is it? When we come to the difficulties about which Paul warns Titus, we are confronted with the problems that the recalcitrant cause. From verses 9-10, we have two impacts upon congregational life of which we must be aware. We need to recognise that such damage for what it is, and they are that the congregation is in such circumstances bound up in activities and situations which are described as useless, as unprofitable and as useless. So the word unprofitable, firstly, means exactly what it says in the Greek, that there is nothing of value to be gained by the activity. Again, Charles Ellicott gives us an explanation of this kind of damage from disputes over the law. St. Paul, well versed thanks to his early and elaborate training in the law, in all this useless and curious stuff, once and for all would expel from Orthodox Christian teaching everything which seemed to bear upon this favourite Jewish theology, so-called. It had a cancer-like effect, eating the life out of Judaism. It should not, if he could prevent it, poison in like manner the young life of the Christian church. Any controversy, any teaching which does not lead to more godliness, more edification of believers in knowledge and understanding, in love and good deeds, is qualified then for rejection as unprofitable. Only things which were good for Christian growth in holy attitudes and behaviour was to be encouraged as profitable. Only things which promoted the peace and the unity of the church or defended it were worthy of the time and the energies of the local pastor, elders and people for their profit. And this is what is meant by these words, profitable and useful. Words which are the opposite of the words that are used here to condemn the damage of the recalcitrant. They describe outcomes that are less than no profit and far less than useful. They are in truth very, very harmful. In fact, another commentator concludes this: not only consuming to no purpose that time which is capable of being much better improved, but also tending to dishevel men's minds, to alienate the affections of Christians from one another, and to render them indifferent to the proper duties of life. There is a Jewish proverb, which is not in the scriptures, which says, when a wise man leaves the room, it has the same effect as when a foolish one enters it. And the reverse is also true. The entry of a fool has the same effect as the departure of a wise man. And the presence of fools, of the petty squabble that leads to rancor and argument and conflict and disturbance, is a consequence. It is basic to their nature that they generate controversy and conflict wherever they go. Charles Benson's words, which I've just quoted, are prophetic in that sense, in all of these circumstances, for the troubles that they bring to the congregation. Now, another matter which is evident from the passage is the word divisive. One of the things that such people do beyond dividing against others in conflict is that they factionalize the church. So not content to just disagree and to pursue useless and harmful arguments, the recalcitrant also try to get others to support them against their opponents. So they get them from within the congregation and occasionally from outside. They try to line people up as allies to force their issue with others. They are not those who agree to disagree. They have the policy of win at any cost. They have no concern of the worst of all impacts, which is schism within the body of Christ, as Charles Benson has said. They alienate the affections of one Christian from another. They start little bushfires between the relationships of others by spreading tales, by falsely claiming people said things, by passing on or claiming critical things which then offend others. And it is very analogous to the careless spread of a virus. The more are infected, the harder it is to get on top of it. So these then are just a couple of the damages that the recalcitrant do when they pursue their petty issues for the sake of personal pride. Let's have a look inside the heart of the recalcitrant as it's revealed in terms of couple of statements in this passage. I chose the word recalcitrant deliberately because these people are a group of people who we will see in the end will not reform. You see this in the reference to the act of resolve in these words in verse 10, reject a divisive man after a first and second warning or admonition. The old translation, interestingly, here reads, a man that is a heretic, reject. The reason for that translation is the Greek word heretikon. We get our word heretic directly from it. It comes from a word which means to choose or to express an opinion. It is associated with, however, with causing division or creating sects, and hence the modern translation factious or divisive. However, the thrust of this word for us today is about the doctrine. And yet in the original, it had more to do with divisiveness. So again, the commentators explain this person's trait. This is Charles Ellicott. He says, the heretic of the Church of Crete appears to have been a man who, dissatisfied with the organization and the discipline introduced by Titus into the Christian community, not improbably considering himself in some way slighted or offended, withdraws himself from the common body and, gathering around him other discontented people, establishes what we might be termed a rival church in Crete. Although at first perhaps no marked erroneous teaching forms part of the practice of such schisms, still the tendency in such small rival communities is ever more and more to distinguish their teaching from that of the larger body from whom they, in the first instance, have cut themselves adrift. Primary driver for division, then, in this case, is not initially doctrine, but a refusal to accept authority. And that is very important. It is a refusal to accept authority in terms of this word. As Mr. Ellicott points out, later they may develop doctrine to distinguish themselves from the former fellowships, the authority of which they would not accept. So what we have here is somebody who simply does not listen to reason, who does not respect the existing authority, who cares nothing for the destructive ways that associate their responses, come from their responses. It is understandable that sometimes someone needs to be spoken to once. We can all fall into that sort of situation. However, that a second is required is, of course, not acceptable. The Greek word here for warning and admonition is a word which involves confrontation, with changing, with a view to changing a mind. Some of you may remember a Presbyterian author named Jay Adams and his book Competent to Counsel. And he called his form of counseling nouthetic counseling, which is this word. It involved facing people with any issues that had caused their emotional state, inevitably sinning. Before I turn to the church's last resort in case, which is the nuclear option, as we might call it, it's also worth reflecting on the heart of such people when someone doesn't listen to valid leadership or when they ignore or defy their requests, judgments and admonitions. Because we are dealing with someone here who cannot have, by definition, the Spirit of God. Someone who cannot have the grace of true conversion. Remember that our attitude to church authority, and indeed to civil authority, is ultimately a reflection of God's higher authority. And if someone will not submit to lawful authority, or worse, if they attack lawful authority, it is first because they have not yet submitted to God's authority. And woe unto such people who actually do resist or attack God's the authority, or its office bearers personally, as is inevitable with recalcitrants. Of course, we have this now at a social level, outside of the church, at epidemic levels in the USA in some states. And that is a terrifying reality in the modern world. However, when people claim to be Christians and reject or attack authority, we have someone who is in a perilous condition and someone who is utterly deluded as to their true state of grace. The Old Testament had the sons of Korah in Moses' time, and the Lord dealt with them in the most severe of terms. Even to challenge Moses' unique right to authority got Miriam, his sister, a deadly dose of leprosy and a week of quarantine outside of the camp, along with God's hot public displeasure. Well, again, we live in an age in which authority is less and less respected, when it is hated, when it is attacked, and when it is violated. But this spirit we know is also can also influence the church, and it is because the hearts of such people have not yet bowed to Jesus Christ as Lord. They are still proud and rebellious, even while they may sing their hymns and read their Bible and argue their points of theology. It is therefore a sobering warning about testing our own hearts regarding our attitude to all authority, because if we fail this test, it may reveal something about ourselves that should really terrify us. Let me turn lastly to the church's response to this, to explain that and to reflect upon it in terms of its nature and implications. So we're looking at the question of the antidote, the unpleasant antidote to the recalcitrant. This passage, with several others, reveals the sad and sobering truth that there are from time to time those in the visible church who ultimately cannot be reasoned with. They are to be met, therefore, with godly resolve, which is the exhortation tonight, to meet the recalcitrant with godly resolve. Because godly counsel, godly appeals, godly wisdom and reason, and of course godly truth all fail to produce the appropriate change in attitude and behaviour. The antidote, therefore, to such behaviour has a number of elements here that bear some scrutiny. The first, of course, is that there must always be warnings to the recalcitrant. People must be given the opportunity to repent. After all, God gives it to us, does he not? The gospel itself is a message of forgiveness on the basis of responding to that great warning that hell awaits for those who do not repent of their sins in rebelling against God and resisting him. In Jesus' famous statement on church discipline, there are two warnings. The first is personal and private, and the second is still private and personal, but it also involves a witness. And then lastly, the matter goes to the church courts to be dealt with. The point is that we are called to try to reform wayward people before we reject them by giving them a legitimate warning in love. Secondly, however, note that it is only two warnings. Each of those warnings must carry with it a clear articulation of the consequences. The boundaries must not only be set to the offender, but they must be limited. Any kind of discipline must be based on the clear connection between the offence and the consequences. We do this with children. We make sure they understand the consequences so that when they break it, the punishment is expected. They have been adequately informed. They must understand, and it is no less true with a recalcitrant adult. The warnings must come after the first sign of trouble. They must be then followed with the second warning after the next sign of trouble. It should also be noted that this second one is the final warning. What follows then is the verb, it's described in the verb to reject. And it is used of the offenders after these two warnings. In our denomination, the language we use to describe rejection is to deny such people access to our church activities, quote unquote. We have no specific practical implications from this word here itself, but the net result is meant to isolate the recalcitrant and their toxic influence from the church and her people. The removal of this, quote, factious person, as it's sometimes translated, depends on the legal standing of that person in the church. For example, for adherents and members, it can be a request or a demand followed by the formal proceedings in terms that I've just mentioned from Matthew 18:15-17. One person goes, the person goes again a second time with a witness, and then the matter goes to the courts of the church. The removal of such persons is more or less traumatic depending on how recalcitrant or disrespectful or how lawless they become. In an age in which insubordination is a growing feature of Western society, this problem is likely to become a larger one in the church and the trauma that it's associated with it. The implication for leaderships is clear, that we must be prepared for the moment by knowing what we can and can't do in dealing with people at each step along the way. The leadership of a congregation is legally responsible for the well-being of its people and its property. It is protected under both church and civil law in the event of a need to reject a factious or recalcitrant person by expelling them from the activities of the life of the church. The involvement of civil authorities in the dispute I'm talking about here with the recalcitrant is one of the final options, as are solicitors. Do you think that I'm over the top at this point in saying this? Do you think that it's extreme that religious people don't need to get to that point? Well, I can assure you that this is the case, that I have had ministry situations where I've had to threaten contact with the police. Our church legal officers have made the law's implications clear, and I have had also the Queensland Police at times confirm this to me. Some of my colleagues have literally marched the recalcitrant off the property personally. But I have known others who have become involved with both the police and also with solicitors. The recalcitrant can be incredibly hardened in their resistance and in their sense of self-righteousness in the pursuit of their various aims. And that's all bound up in that word, reject, a factious man. When the apostle warned Titus about such people, he did so to give him the wisdom and the tools necessary to protect the congregation from some extremely destructive people. People who had no respect for authority, beginning, of course, with God's authority. But remember, the good shepherd confronts the wolf. Like David, he is prepared to engage them in real conflict. And in such circumstances, leadership is not for the faint-hearted. It requires a clear knowledge of right and wrong, of when to draw the line between acceptable and unacceptable behaviour. It requires a right mix of mercy and justice, and of patience and punishment. It also requires a great deal of courage. The recalcitrant ultimately will always push the leadership into a place where there are no other choices but their rejection for the necessary protection of the flock. Reject a factious man, as the text says, after a first and second warning. In conclusion, then, we ought not be surprised, based on this text and many others, that conflicts do come to the church. Sometimes, as I've said, it is caused by good men making bad mistakes. But sometimes it is simply bad men being themselves. In defending the flock against those who err, our Saviour was not averse to the assertion of strength. Whether in attacking errors or hypocrisy of the false shepherds, of the scribes, or of the Pharisees, He remains concerned for the flock, as is evidenced by his intolerance of evil and evil people in the letters to the seven churches. From time to time, the church is troubled by schisms and conflict. But without confronting the recalcitrant person, which leads, of course, to conflict and at times these kinds of necessary schisms, without that, then the recalcitrant will triumph and many people will be hurt and driven off. Shepherding the flock as he did means the employment of strength. As the Catechism says, he defends us against his enemies and ours, but he does it through shepherds who are both tender and tough, as he himself was. Tender, if that will work for repentance in the recalcitrant, and toughness if it will not. We need, therefore, to meet the rebellious with godly resolve, or else the ungodly will run amok to the misery and the harm of our fellowships. Let's all pray. Our God and our Father, as we have come face to face with the extreme end of one problem in the life of the church, as we have heard sobering and difficult things tonight from the passage, we recognise that it's not there because it's not necessary. We do thank you for the wisdom that it affords us, the insights that it gives us into the tragedies that is human nature at times. We thank you also for reminding us for those who are involved in leadership of various kinds of what is to come, that we go into these works day by day, meeting by meeting, year by year, with their eyes wide open to these things. We thank you for the grace that you give to our leaders to be able to withstand the assaults of the enemy through failing men. And we do pray that in this place and in every place, that there would be godly resolve to meet the challenges of those who fall into such errors. This we pray in our Saviour's name. Amen. So we're going to sing our fourth hymn of praise this evening, March On, My Soul with Strength. Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.